Welcome to this evening's Turner event. I'm Catherine Sullivan, the curator of the Janet Turner Print Museum, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to our second event dealing with our exhibition Wide Open Spaces. This evening we have Dr. David Farmer, who is a retired director of rare books libraries, a teacher, a curator, a photographer, and an author of articles, exhibition catalogs, and biographies of writers, printmakers, and notable figures in the world of books and collecting. He has a BA and an MA from Trinity University and a PhD from the University of Texas at Austin. His seminal work on the Texas Printmakers Organization, of which Janet Turner is a part, began as a lecture for the 20th Annual North American Print Conference and was subsequently published as a chapter in Prints and Printmakers of Texas, published by the Texas State Historical Association, and that book is available for you to look at on our gallery table in the museum. He has also written an article for the Tamarind Papers in 1989, where he drew upon the unpublished correspondence to explore the career of Constance Forsythe, who was an assistant to Thomas Hart Benton, also an instructor of Janet Turner's, and an accomplished printmaker who established the graphic arts program at the University of Texas at Austin shortly after World War II. Other contributions by Farmer were included in Past to the Press, Printmaking and American Women Artists, 1910 to 1960, which is also on our table in the gallery for you to look at, and was published in 2006 by the Beach Museum of Art, Kansas State University. Dr. Farmer's most recent book is devoted to a printmaker and printer who came to Santa Fe during the Depression and created a body of work still highly regarded for capturing the spirit of a small Rocky Mountain community quickly became a center of the arts. Willard Clark, Printer and Printmaker, was first published in 2000 and has had repeat publications since then. Last year, Dr. Farmer co-curated Pressing Through Time, 150 Years of Printmaking in Taos, a multi-venue set of exhibitions in Taos, museums, and galleries that featured over 600 prints. While preparing Pressing Through Time, he created a website for the exhibits, the print demonstration program, and a symposium, also while writing a set of blogs on the earlier history of printmaking in Taos. The site is still running today. He is currently finishing research on 19th century artists whose prints reached a wide audience through books and popular press. And so today he's here to talk about Janet's career that some of us might not be as familiar with, that started before she came to Chico. And after he's finished with his presentation, he and I will have a conversation with you on developing her context. And so this evening he is here to put her early work in the context of regional and international printmaking. So I'd like you to welcome Dr. David Farmer.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much for that lovely introduction, and it's great to be here, and welcome. I want to thank Catherine and also her colleague over in the library, George Thompson, for all of the help that they gave my wife Carol and me in January when we came to do research on Janet Turner. There was another event going on down at the campus at Southern Methodist University where I was to speak. And so I had to come to the source, and here it is. And those days that we spent here last January were sheer delight. It's really, I spent my career working with archives and rare books and art. And when you meet people who are dedicated and just these committed stewards for the collections that they're responsible for, it's just a sheer joy. And I wanted to say that. And I want to say thank you yet again to my beloved Carol, my wife, who has been at my side for 55 years as we've trucked about the country doing research on various figures. And she was with me again, and she's here tonight. And I want to say thank you again, dear. So. Turner's career as a printmaker began shortly before she graduated from Stanford University. Born in Kansas City in 1914, her interest in nature led her to major in botany at Stanford. After the university discouraged her from majoring in biology, a field, they told her, that was not really open to women. Well, halfway through her undergraduate years in the botany program, Stanford scaled it down. So Turner switched to Far Eastern history and graduated with distinction in 1936. In her senior year, she took several drawing classes without considering a career in art. And as she learned to draw, she began cutting and printing linoleum blocks, including animals, to which she would be drawn all of her life, and scenes around the Stanford campus, such as Stanford columns along the inner quad, which is what she titled this lineup cut. It was printed in an edition of 50, and it's one of her earliest prints. Employment prospects were minimal for a woman graduating from college in 1936 with a major in Far Eastern history. The Great Depression was still dragging on. Women were seldom hired if men were available for employment. And with some 9 million men in America jobless, Turner didn't have any job prospects. So she postponed her search after graduation, and with help from her family, she traveled on a Phi Delta Kappa tour through parts of Japan, China, the Philippines, Manchuria, and Korea. And this was her first trip to Japan, where she would return later with more extensive knowledge of printmaking techniques. And I'm including these wonderful images of her passport. She saved everything. And this is a joy to find with any creative individual. And the passports are here in the collections, and we were able to scan those as we were working in January. Back home in September, she enrolled in the Kansas City Art Institute for a 5-year graduate arts program. And here she is in one of the sketching classes. There, her skills developed quickly as she studied painting with Thomas Hart Benton and illustration and lithography with John DeMartelli. Both of these artists and teachers were at the center of the regionalist movement. Both were prominent on the national scene, and both encouraged their students to begin entering juried exhibits elsewhere in the country so they might gain confidence and recognition that comes with a strong CV. This was a lesson Turner learned well, for throughout her career, she submitted work for juried shows assiduously and submitted notices of her recognition to a variety of publications. Her clipping files, scrapbooks, and resumes were a testament to this thoroughly professional approach to the making and the teaching of art. Kansas City Art Institute DeMartelli, whose lithograph of his we see now, brought to the classroom a solid background in printmaking through his study at the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts, as well as his representation by the Associated American Artists in New York City in the 1930s and 1940s. A resurgence of interest in prints was taking place in the 20th century, early 20th century America. It was growing out of 19th century printmaking societies here in the U.S., with increasing numbers of artists, museums, and collectors drawn into the sphere of prints and printmaking. Juried annual and biennial print shows played significant roles in developing further awareness of prints. The Associated American Artists was taking out ads in popular magazines that had national circulation, and art schools devoted more attention to printmaking, such as the Provincetown Printmakers and the Art Students League, which we see here in New York City, where printmaking assumed a significant role in the curriculum, thanks to teachers like Arthur Wesley Dow and Kenneth Hayes Miller.
In time, Janet Turner would become a good friend of Kenneth Miller's. Turner attuned to this emerging history while studying at Kansas City Art Institute. She began to build her own exhibition record. A few more years, her work would be included in numerous exhibits at the Dallas Museum of Fine Arts. In 1940, she exhibited at the Philadelphia Print Club and the Associated American Artists in New York in a show of work by Benton students. The next year, her watercolors, paintings, and prints were included in 7 shows, including the Museum of New Mexico in Santa Fe, the Denver Art Museum, and the Six States Exhibition in Omaha, where 2 of her watercolors were selected for an all-year exhibition. In 1941, she completed her study at Kansas City, and the following year landed a position at Claremont in the Girls Collegiate School. The Depression was ending, but World War II was starting with its rationing of tires, cars, gasoline, shoes, sugar, and other goods. Her letters home reflect the difficulties of living on a modest salary while also attempting to stay current with art openings in the Los Angeles area during the war. She wasn't a clothes horse, but she clearly enjoyed dressing nicely, and her mother helped by sending packages from home containing items of clothing and even an occasional pair of stockings, clearly a luxury at the time. Other packages from her family contained food. As soon as she took up her full-time teaching responsibilities at the Girls Collegiate School in Claremont at $45 a month, Turner began entering her work in exhibits ranging from the artists of Los Angeles and vicinity, and then, not so far away, the San Francisco Art Association, and also the first international print show sponsored by the Texas Fine Arts Association. So you can see that the geographic reach she was staying, she was not only aware of what was going on out there, she was participating in it. And in 1943, she was given a one-woman exhibition at the Philbrook Art Center in Tulsa that featured her watercolors and lithographs. After her first 2 years in full-time teaching responsibility, she found a side job designing menus and programs for the Padua Hills Dinner Theater with a significant raise in salary. She made, in this part-time job, $75 a month. And this allowed her to reduce her teaching load to half-time at Claremont. So she could walk across campus to Scripps, where she began working on her MFA, studying with another major figure in mid-century American art, Millard Sheets. During the next few years, she didn't have time to exhibit much, but she did have a little extra pocket money that could help with transportation, even though gasoline was still rationed. She wanted a car, but she thought she could save money if she bought a Harley-Davidson motorcycle with a sidecar. And she tried, but the dealer couldn't arrange delivery in wartime. When I read this in the beautifully organized Turner Archives here, I wish the motorcycle deal had come to fruition, because I'd love to have shown you a photograph of Janet on Harley Davidson. Yay! Well, it would have been splendid. But in 1947, she finished her MFA and she landed a job at a university with a university appointment in the art department at Stephen F. Austin College in Nacogdoches as assistant professor in art education. While the quiet town of Nacogdoches was rich in history and surrounded by East Texas woods and wildlife, it seemed remote for Turner. Fresh from her undergraduate years at Stanford, her studies in Kansas City, and the enriching experiences teaching and studying at Claremont. Yet, the next 9 years at Nacogdoches were intense and productive. Natural habitats like the Big Thicket were nearby, rich in the wildlife, especially birds that she loved to observe. She turned more and more to printmaking in the evenings because her daytime workload had been loaded with a lot of, you know what happens to assistant professors. Yeah, a lot of committee assignments, registering and advising students, and these jobs absorbed those daylight hours when the light was best for painting. So she turned more to prints. Her exhibition record during her first year at Stephen F. Austin might have made other aspiring young colleagues wobbly in the knees. 27 separate shows, including ones in San Francisco, New York City, at the National Academy of Design, St. Louis, a one-woman show back at Scripps, 10 paintings, 50 drawings and prints, work selected for the first Southwestern print exhibition at back at the Dallas Museum of Fine Arts, work shown to the Northwestern printmakers in Seattle, the first Central States Graphic Arts Annual at the Joslin in Omaha, Washington Watercolor Club in D.C., and the Texas Printmakers Circuit. More about them in a moment. Scattered throughout this array of exhibits, Janet Turner won prizes, awards of merit, and invitations for additional one-woman shows. And this was just her first year as assistant professor in art education. And this is a good time to take a look at some of what she was doing at the time and drawing significant attention around the country with this work. Here's Calf Auction Lot, and there are a number of slides that relate to this. It's a four-block lino cut. She did in 1948. And I'm having trouble seeing this on the screen. I don't know which one of the blocks this is, but you can see the detail of what happens in a block. Those of you who have made prints or spent a lot of time around prints know that it's a mind-twisting business to be working in reverse and to know where this is all going to end up. But this is a proof of one of them, another proof. And then finally, what the finished print looks like. This one is Abstraction. It's a serigraph that she made in 1952, just a couple of years after that workshop in New York with Landon. And then Night Watcher, a serigraph from 1955. And clearly she's taking the opportunity to work with subjects that she's seeing over there in the big thicket. Once a Boat is just one of these remarkable prints. It's a two-block lino cut, 1951. It was accepted into 17 juried exhibitions, and it won 7 awards along the way. Black Vultures, a lino cut from 1950. Powerhouse Construction, a color serigraph from 52. And a few years later, Farewell Victoria. And then Guinea Fowl. This is a five-block lino cut, and it was in 1952 that she finished the watercolor titled Guinea Fowl. And Catherine showed us the work that she did, the preliminary work that she did in terms of watercolors and sketches to determine what direction she wanted to take, how she was going to solve it. In print that was selected by the Metropolitan Museum of Art for their 1952 American Watercolor Drawing and Print Exhibition. It gained further notice from the American Federation of Arts when they asked to include it in their traveling exhibit for the year. And in a letter from the American Federation, the representative said, quote, "The selecting jury felt the work listed in the enclosure is of particular distinction. Thus, Guinea Fowl, in an edition of 75, began its journey around the country at a time when this print sold for $30. Mm-hmm. Well, let's catch our breath and turn to an organization I mentioned earlier, the Texas Printmakers. This group is an early example of women artists coming together in the late 1930s and making a significant mark in an art world largely dominated by men. The Texas Printmakers first organized under the name of the Printmakers Guild in 1939, a year after the exclusively male Lone Star Printmakers was formed by Jerry Bywaters, Otis Dozier, Alexander Hogue, Charles Bowling, Merritt Mausay, and others, who totally ignored accomplished women artists who were colleagues and peers. This is Corrine Spellman at Texas Woman's University. But some of the others that were working at the same time: Stella Lamont, SMU, chaired the art department, taught. Florence McClung, Trinity University, chaired the department, taught, made art, continues. And these were only some of the significant and accomplished women printmakers around Texas who participated in the Texas Printmakers, along with Janet Turner. When overlooked by the Lone Star printmakers, they formed their own organization, open only to women. Well, the guys did it. Why couldn't they do it for themselves? And they decided on an ambitious plan that created 5 portfolios, because with prints as multiples, you can put together a set of portfolios with examples from your editions. And they circulated them all over the United States. These women stayed in touch, and there's nothing unusual about this, but over the years, they, even after that organization ended its 25-year run, they were in touch with one another. And one of the delights of that, to be able to find how artists communicate and with one another, is a set of Christmas cards that Janet Turner did. These were sent a friend of mine in the Bywaters collection at SMU, clued me into these. They were processing a collection of Barbara Maples, and that's whose name Janet, you see one of these she sent from Nacogdoches, and then after she moved here to Chico State, she continued sending these seasonal cards and of these lovely little prints. Much earlier, when she took up her post at Stephen F. Austin in 1947, she joined the Texas Printmakers and enlarged her network amongst Texas artists, along with the expanding geographic reach of her prints. And then the following 3 years were even more active for Turner. Her work was shown in 75 exhibits. She won first prize for painting, Texas Fine Arts Association, the Richard McLary Prize, Dallas Print Society, $75 print prize from the Art Association of New Orleans, and a $250 Dealey purchase prize from the Dallas Museum of Fine Arts. The Dealey family was involved in the Dallas Morning News, and they were marvelous supporters of the arts. And you can see with a prize of $250 at the time, that's significant support. And I've shortened this list of what Janet Turner, with the recognition that she was given at this time. This all may sound like smooth sailing for an artist and a teacher, but there were ill winds too in Texas. She happened to be working in an art department whose chairman, in her words, quote, simply didn't know what it was all about, art, shows, etc. And from her correspondence, it becomes clear Dr. Carl Schleicher did not value her growing record of work exhibited all over the nation. She wrote her close friend Wright Morris that the chairman, quote, learns slowly, teaches and formulates all ideas from books and other authority, but he means well, and being handsome and full of statistics, pleases the president. What impressed him most was a letter from Jerry Bywaters, and that's one more image that I was, oh, it's here. I thought that this little mean computer had dropped this out. This is a self-portrait, Jerry. What impressed her chairman most was a letter from Jerry Bywaters saying not only that the painting Sweet Corn was voted on in San Antonio, Houston, and Dallas by 3 times the number of popular votes as its nearest competitor, he also thought it was a very good example of tempera painting. The chairman told Turner he couldn't understand this, but was pleased for her. She commented in her letter to Morris that her chairman saw no connection between personal reputation and teaching. He apparently understood little about Prince and in time suggested she abandon her representational work and move into abstract expressionism, the then current direction of American art. And he also instructed his faculty, or at least he instructed Turner, that any contact with the press would have to come through his office. The arts and entertainment editors of the Texas newspapers loved Janet Turner because the scope of her recognition moved beyond state borders and into other significant centers of art. This made good copy because it made Texas look good too. And instructions about the press from the chairman's office did not reduce the column entries devoted to her because her network was so well established with recognition and support from Jerry Bywaters and many others. She was simply quietly passed story leads that soon made their way to the newspaper writers. And once they were on to something they wanted to write about, not even an academic department chair could stop them. So the clipping files grew along with Janet Turner's reputation. In the 1940s and 50s, Dallas and Fort Worth were vital art centers for Texas and that part of the Southwest. And Turner's involvement there contributed to her reputation. At the end of the spring semester in 1952, she received the following letter. Dear Miss Turner, as you may know, the Betty McLean Gallery has now been open for over a year, and we're gradually adding to the group of painters we represent. We originally started handling a group of 9 Texas painters. I'm not going to go through the list, but at any rate, I can say that those names that she mentions up there, every one of them had, during their lifetime and since their passing, significant one-person shows. And she was being invited to join that gallery. Here's a picture of Betty McLean later in her life. She introduced a significant opportunity for Janet Turner to widen the reach and to be shown along with other artists of note. Moreover, the gallery helped her prepare the shows they arranged with framing, shipping, record keeping, all critical routines for any full-time faculty member. Turner's reply revealed her interest in new representation, but she also noted that her work was already being shown quite widely across the country, with prints offered at Landau's in Los Angeles, James Butte Company in Houston, Mid-America Gallery and Lawrence Gallery in Kansas City, Kennedy's and Knoedler's in New York, George Binet in Massachusetts, and Pan American Gallery in San Antonio. Betty McLean and Janet Turner resolved these questions of representation, and Turner began her association with this significant Dallas gallery before the end of the year. Although departmental politics at Stephen F. Austin did not improve, Turner continued her professional rise as the recipient of a Guggenheim in 1953 to research the combination of relief printing and serigraphy in a single print, a new development in technique that few others had even considered. Over the course of the next year, she was also able to experiment and perfect the combination of silkscreen image over an image printed with woodblocks or lino cuts, thereby achieving a subtle but more painterly result in the finished print. Black Vultures is a good example of her new technique. The year Turner was awarded the Guggenheim, 1953, she was also elected associate member of the National Academy of Design in New York. In 1954, she traveled to Japan again, where 15 prints and drawings were exhibited in a one-woman show at the Yoshida Gallery. And here's her passport photograph for that trip at the Yoshida Gallery in Tokyo, followed by an exhibition of 20 prints and a two-hour demonstration of lino cuts and serigraphs at the American Cultural Center in Tokyo. While in Japan, she wrote to the McLean Gallery, quote, fantastically, two things seem to be happening. My work is more Japanese than the currently produced Japanese work, which is imitative Parisian. I had to keep trying to explain my work was Western. It was not under a Japanese teacher. Secondly, instead of my learning from the Japanese woodblock artists with whom I'd become acquainted, there seems to be more they want to learn from my methods. Perhaps the reason the peak of skill of the block printers was 100 years ago, when the artist did not do either his carving or his printing. Recently, when the artist began doing their own work, technical problems arose, and the artist hadn't been trained to think them out. At any rate, it's a peculiar switch. While in Tokyo, Turner also wrote a comparison of modern Japanese and American art for the monthly English language publication, Art Around Town. Here she observed that in both countries there was much interest in experimentation and new techniques, but that American artists, lacking tradition and earlier developed skills of the Japanese, have been more inclined to experiment in all forms of painting. It's a very interesting essay, and it's in the collection just across the way in the archives in the library. By 1956, with few signs of positive change in the art department at Stephen F. Austin, Janet Turner put together another plan. She decided to better her chances for a new job by earning a PhD in art education at Columbia University. With finances always stretched, she made ends meet in New York by working as a teaching assistant in the Teachers College at Columbia. Moreover, 1957 and 58 were very good years in New York to see what was emerging from the abstract expressionist. And just as her time in LA, in the greater LA area, where she visited galleries, she did the same in New York. This was also the year when someone, Agnes Martin, for example, moved to New York and found a studio down at Coentis Slip in Lower Manhattan that included Robert Indiana, Ellsworth Kelly, Lenore Tawney, and others, all drawn to the cheap rents and the loft spaces. There's no doubt that Janet Turner saw their work and thought about the future direction of her own art. But there was also time to work in stone lithography, which she could not do at Stephen F. Austin. They had no lithography press. And one of the lithographs she made in New York was The Prey, 1957, an accomplished work on stone. As Turner studied for her PhD at Columbia, the art department at Stephen F. Austin extended the academic leave, so her path was open for a return to her previous position. But while networking with other artists and studying with exceptional professors of art education at Columbia, she was gaining insights and confidence that helped her handle the situation back in Texas. While in New York, she had a job offer from Georgia State College for Women in Milledgeville, and then a letter from Austin College in Sherman asking if she would come and chair their art department. Turner told her sister she didn't want to relocate anywhere in the South, and that she was more interested in teaching and making art than in administration. And then the job offer came from Chico State, seeking a qualified art teacher with a background in art education and the abilities to strengthen the department over time. They also tripled Janet Turner's salary, but this was a good news, bad news story in itself. She was going to an established college with a strong university state system, a good salary level, and a department where collegiality was valued. But she was leaving New York and Texas, where the sales of her art had been consistently strong. And it was also the time when her mother died, and she was missing her siblings. She wrote to her friend Wright Morris, quote, "My biggest drop has been in drying up of art sales. Never great, I did get enough in Texas and New York to pay expenses, which amount to about $2,000 a year when exhibiting, paying dues to organizations, shipping, etc. My reputation here is almost nil." Well, that was back then. It certainly changed. "The paintings last spring impressed some, but not the art circle buyers." Her expenses of $2,000 in that year of 1959 and 60 would be about $16,000 today. But her situation began to change very quickly after coming to Chico, And you all know the story, so I'm not going to go into that. You know it better than I. She shaped new courses, dedicated her work, helped strengthen academic programs. She also discovered the glories of nearby Bidwell Park. She made her own collections of prints, judiciously selected for teaching purposes, and then gave the collection to the university. She taught several generations of printmakers and was honored by her peers throughout the university system as outstanding university professor. But there's a part of these West Coast years near the end that may not be as widely known. It was an exhibit back in Texas just 3 years before she died. The successor to her old Dallas gallery had become Valley House Gallery, where they offered her a major retrospective exhibition. Donald Vogel, who had been a manager for Betty McLane, then started Valley House, and he had worked with her when she was 38, and he later, from his Valley House base, was beginning to turn over the operations in 85 to his son and daughter-in-law, Kevin and Cheryl Vogel. And it was through them that Donald Vogel reached out to Janet Turner and offered a major retrospective of her prints. By this time, she had all the distinction here that you know and I have mentioned. She had given her papers as well as the print collection to Chico. And in Dallas in 1985 at Valley House, Janet Turner had a beautiful show. It was well received. Accolades came as a distinguished figure in art education. She was recognized as that and in American printmaking. This is the setting at Valley House. It's an exquisite garden, landscaped and peaceful. And now, some 30 years later, we have the occasion with another exhibition of her work as Chico State University celebrates the new facilities that house the Janet Turner Museum. A fitting time to consider the life and works of this remarkable artist and teacher whose prints continue to draw us into the mystery and the silence of birds. Thank you very much.
So I want to thank you very much for filling this in. As I've long known the Chico experience of Janet being such a long-term experience for our community, not everyone has the knowledge that she really came here as an artist with a really established reputation and a very established aesthetic. At the same time, she produces a new body of work, obviously reflective of the space that she's in.
And it was an interesting path because it was, if any of you have been in East Texas or been to Nacogdoches, that part of Texas, you know how sort of isolated it is, and you think of it as a place that's pretty cut off from what's happening anywhere else. But that didn't slow her down because she not only networked there in Texas, in the region. And that's why I wanted to mention a number of those venues where she exhibited. But she was going back to New York, and she was traveling as best she could at the time. And she was serving on committees, too, that Jerry Bywaters from the Dallas Museum of Art appointed, state committees for, and juries. So she was plugged in.
It's surprising to me how much she actually directed her career, and then she goes to Nacogdoches, and when she's in the East Texas area, it doesn't surprise me that she met up with these women printmakers, Janet being a person that would want to be in community, and that those women, it's a surprising how many of them ended up being major players in academia in terms of the teaching, so they would be influencing future generations, but also how they were very determined to market themselves. So.
Yes, they did. it's really admirable. We think now in terms of the kind of communication that we have with the internet and email and all that. But what they were doing was, they were putting these portfolios on buses and sending them off to other parts of the country where they had networked and they had made arrangements with the library or with the civic center. And it was natural for them. I mean, they loved doing this, and they didn't blink at the difficulty in doing it. But they built their networks, and they maintained them. Those wonderful cards are an example of how they stayed in touch with one another.
There was actually Janet continued to do those for a very long time, and there was actually kind of two tiers of cards, so you kind of knew where you were in the hierarchy. If you got a fully screened printed card, those are the ones that were most desirable. And if you were an acquaintance, you got the commercially reproduced version of the same thing. I was in the second tier.
That makes sense.
So the interesting thing in the collection, that a number of the women, I often wondered in the initial donation she made of 450 prints that first went to special collections before they returned to the museum, it's in that category of the donation, is the Blanche McVeighs and the Stella Lamond and those women that would have been the printmaking guild women. And I didn't really know until you were talking about how the likelihood is she probably got them when they came back from the tours, and they go through the boxes and they start exchanging them. And so there's like, and Janet's selection of them tend to be the screen prints, so that is interesting that she was really looking at that particular technique from a very early point in the use of screen printing as an art technique. At the same time, she's collecting those people's work that represent that, more so than some of the other techniques.
Because some of them were doing lithographs and in time they were
printing.
And aquatints, Bess Hubbard did aquatints and others too. But I'm not surprised. I'm intrigued with screen printing and the emergence of that out of the WPA workshop, in especially in New York, where there were plans that were implemented to simplify the process so it could then be used in schools around the country, and not just at the university level but at secondary level, and they printed. Out of that WPA workshop, there was a little manual for constructing a silkscreen press, and it began to spread around the country in the schools. And you mentioned that, you know, most of these women were involved in education, in art education, one degree or another, one level or another, So it's natural that this would appeal to them. They could employ it. Those who were teaching in high school or in other grades could employ that in their teaching. And then they started making silkscreen prints that are knockouts. You know, it's a lovely story, and it's one that cheers me up.
One of the things I've always found interesting is the number of women in printmaking. It's almost because they are really focused educationally, they're really there to be teachers first, not artists, in terms of what they're doing. In a way, they kind of fly under the radar, and printmaking becomes a way that they become really bona fide and recognized artists through the method of printmaking via the door of education. It's not like they just went out and said, oh, I'm going to be a printmaking artist. Through education, got the way up that ladder.
You know, and I think, Catherine, one of the things that we observed when Carol and I started, we were collecting prints at the time, and, you know, and then the market ran away from us, and we were left in the dust. But as we began in the 80s getting interested in that group of women printmakers there, it was clear to us that, I mean, they'd been ignored. I mean, they'd been forgotten, for God's sake. And that show at SMU helped bring them out. And I think in a way they were overlooked because they were in education. And so what? And it's a sad commentary on what happens in art circles and gallery circles and museum circles that these judgments are made. But you know, then the pendulum swings. And I just got an invitation this afternoon, a cell phone call, and to speak about the Printmakers Guild, the Texas Printmakers, for a conference in Fort Worth next April, which is a conference of it's CASETA. I don't know what it stands for. What it stands for is people with means to collect at a level that I can't touch. But at any rate, I'm honored that they wanted me to come and speak and about that group. But you know, those it's, I think, things in terms of pendulum swinging, and that the fact that they were ignored for so long, that's over. They're out there. I mean, their work is out there, and it's being recognized and collected by museums as well as individuals. But I, you know, why these judgments are made, I don't know.
I know I do get usually at least once a month. There's usually now someone that calls that has a Janet Turner, and they're actually in areas where she has still a reputation, Kansas, Texas, and they sometimes, and so they usually want to know what things are worth, which as a curator, it's a conflict of interest for me to tell you what things are worth, because they're all valuable to me and I wouldn't know and I'm not supposed to tell. But there is an increasing interest in that time period, I think, because it is, in fact, if it hadn't existed, there wouldn't be the glorious academic presence of printmaking that has continued and flourished today without those women at the beginning that were so dogged about two things, being practicing artists and being really excellent educators.
It's a wonderful story. And to see the dedication that they had, it really is heartwarming. And here's, I mean, Turner was amazing in terms of that dedication to the classroom. To teaching and sharing. There are no secrets. I mean, there are no secrets in this. Yeah. How to make it around. It's
practice.
It's practice.
So, any comments? Yes.
I wonder if you could speak a bit more about her reputation after coming to Chico. Was she still ascending at that time? What kind of reputation developed after that?
In the Southwest, yes. Now, I don't. You might know about this, Catherine, in terms of her exhibition record after she was very well established here and, you know, moving along. I don't know about the exhibitions back in Texas. They weren't, or the Southwest, they weren't paying the kind of attention that I would like to see to prints at some of the regional museums in the area where she had lived and shown. But she was remembered because there were people at a lecture I did a couple of months ago back in Dallas. I was delighted by the questions that came from people who had been very serious collectors of her work and following it for years, for decades. So it's there's a nucleus here and there. And you know, it's moved beyond that now, because museums like the Amon Carter Museum in Fort Worth has a remarkable collection of American prints, and it includes work by Janet Turner and some of those colleagues of hers in the Texas Printmakers too. But that's just one example of a number of museums, Dallas Museum of Art, and then some of the smaller museums in East Texas and on up into the Four Corners area in New Mexico and Arizona and over into Oklahoma. So it's grown. But there are some people who kept the light, who kept the torch going as collectors while others were getting ready to catch up.
I have another kind of muddled question. scar on her right thumb. Is that accurate, or is that a scar?
Oh, we're looking at that photograph.
It does.
Do you know anything about that?
I actually don't. Do you know?
No, I don't.
I do remember her being bandaged.
Yeah.
So I don't know if it was like, you know, I seriously, that's her right hand, so she was left-handed.
Oh. Just to add to what David said, or your question, here on the West Coast after she arrived in Chico, yes, her reputation did continue to grow. She did exhibit a lot. I remember one show in particular at the Marquardt Gallery in San Francisco, a one-person exhibition, and it included the blocks for her koi prints.
And they included the blocks in the exhibit?
Yes. And also the, not just the prints themselves, but the drawings and stuff that she had. I coveted those.
And one thing about her time in Chico, she also had a very active dealer in arts and crafts, and Joe Caveney. So the editions that she did print generally sold out. So there was wide dispersal of her work in the marketplace as much as the actual, I don't know that, I think to a large degree, a lot of her focus was actually in the production of the work and having it in the marketplace, and maybe not so much in being in every show. She was shown regularly, and she has groups of prints like at Library of Congress, and she had groups of prints at U.S. embassies and things like that. But generally, she was like pretty much on this path, like she did an edition a year of something, and it generally sold out. So she was really focused on the production and the sale of her work, which is, as an artist, you want your work out there. She wasn't ever kind of an artist that just wanted to do it for the expression of doing. It's like, if you're an artist, you must be doing one of two things, selling or showing, or you're not an artist.
Well, and that was what she was bumping into in that department back in Nacogdoches, where they didn't, the chair at any rate, didn't understand that because, I mean, didn't understand the relationship between making art and being accepted in a wide circle of critical judgment for that art and recognition and work in the classroom and how it all comes together. And I love that story about the blocks being included in the exhibit and proofs. One of the wonderful things about that I never met her, but that I learned in doing this research and have heard from others is how she and some other printmakers and teachers of printmaking always would say, there is no secret to this. It is skill that must be developed through careful practice and knowledge of process. And there are no secrets. And so there is something that is infinitely engaging about prints when you can see how they have come about. And to be able to look at a block and look at a gorgeous print like any of the number of those that we showed and to be able to see what the parts were that had to come together in precisely the right sequence with the right inking and the right registration and of course the right vision as an artist. And to include the blocks with the prints helps people connect with an art form that is to some quite mysterious.
Probably just add in here to one of your comments, the monies that Janet got from the sale of her prints, plus the great big network that she created, were extremely important vehicles in helping to build the incredible collection that we now have here. And so she used both of those very productively for a greater good.
You all probably know Dan and Dan Leno and Gayla Chamberlain down just over the road here at Annex Gallery. Dan told me a story one time about when Janet would come down to, on the weekend to buy some prints for the study collection here. And as with any dealer, there are things which, you know, rise above others and some which you have them, but you don't really show them. And he pulled out a print by Leonard Baskin. And he said, at the time I pulled it out, he said, I realized I didn't intend to show this. And so he says to Janet Turner, oh, Janet, this, you're not going to want this. This is really not a very good print. And it's not the way it was printed. It's just the conceptualization and the execution. And it just, you know, he did a heck of a lot better. And she stopped him. She said, I'll take it. He looked at her and she said, how are students going to learn how to go about this if they can't see where a master printer didn't quite get it? And so she bought the print, and it's in your collection.
We have a number of baskets, so she bought in all ranges.
That's wonderful.
Well, you're welcome to join us. We're going to adjourn across the way, and so the gallery will be open, so if you have any questions you'd like to ask, or conversations you'd like to have, we'll be going across the breezeway. So let's thank David again for his wonderful...
In this era when people expect art to be such an immediate form, how do you explain the importance of printmaking?
There's something that's very peaceful about printmaking and contemplative about printmaking. It's not an immediate thing. There are all sorts of things you can create with light and sound and video that just knocks you over in wonderful imaginative ways, but this is another process for making art that is quieter. And it's something that amongst artists who like it, they share it, and they love working together. And because you can just, you are lost in this world of beauty and color and technical stuff too. That's part of what I think some people have difficulty connecting with, it because you have to, those techniques that you use in making prints are not easily won. A lot of practice, but if you've got it, it's a beautiful process to see happen.
Well, you're so welcome.
Yeah.